of that continues to build. It's not a practice or a process that I ever feel like I got. I learn on each project I'm doing, I'm learning something new. And since we have known each other since we were young people, before I even started it, you know how wild and crazy and undisciplined I used to be, right? And so a lot of this work, a lot of people are like, oh, that must be so fun and so creative, doing screenplays, writing movies. And I really feel like the creative piece of it is like the 2%, you know, but it's really been this long process for me of practicing discipline, coming to the work, creating structure, creating a space to do the work, creating the discipline. It's like going to the gym, right? You want to be fit, you want to feel good, you want to be healthy. You can't say, oh, I did it. Oh, I went to the gym in 1987. How come I'm not feeling good now?
In 2017.
Right.
Right, right, right.
It doesn't work that way. So you can't go, oh, I know that. Right? It's a continuous, like you have to feed yourself daily by trying to practice and discipline yourself to do the work.
That's like any other practice. That's like with anything.
Exactly.
So to speak, I'm not trying to minimalize writing. I'm just saying everything for me that I've ever wanted to do that I did not know, and I did know,
right,
whether it was natural or not, if I wanted to cultivate what I had naturally, I had to practice what I had.
Right.
Right? Practice, learn the skills, that the structure that helped build that natural skill. And if I didn't know anything, I definitely better have a practice in my life that speaks to cultivating whatever it is that I'm gearing my talent towards or trying to cultivate. Whether it's swinging a hammer. Listen, I didn't know how to swing a hammer. I didn't know how to hit a nail with a hammer at one time. Right. There's a practice to that. There's a technique and
exactly.
took practice.
Right.
You know, I would hit a nail and I'd be hitting it like 5, 6, 7 times.
Yeah.
I got on jobs and they see me doing that. They wouldn't ask me back.
Right.
And I asked one day why, and they said, you don't even know how to drive a nail.
Right.
And I noticed the other guys were like driving the nails 1, 2 hits sometimes, you know?
Right.
And it was amazing, you know?
Right.
So just as simple as that.
Yeah.
You know, something. And then we're going into screenwriting.
Right.
Oh my
so
God.
Think about back in the day when we were in a club at, you know, 17, 19, and we're like, oh, this is what I'm going to do. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm going to write the great American novel. I'm going to do that. You know, it was all fantasy.
I want to talk about that. I want to talk, because I know you've written some, a couple of books, I believe. Were you published at one time?
Short story.
I
never did the novel. You know, I got into writing film. And then just had job after job, so I haven't, maybe one day, but haven't done it.
Yeah.
You know?
Are you published at any point as far as your writing is concerned, like besides the screenplays?
No.
I'm looking forward to that from you. You know?
Yeah.
Give me a second, Kate. I want to read this. We just got this across our desk. Listen, first of all, I wanted to thank Dan Johnson and Ray. Dan Johnson is our lead engineer here at Community Access. He's the man who does a sound check and, you know, make sure all the equipment is plugged in and turned on and tweaked. Dan, I really appreciate your work with us and helping us bring this program to life. And Ray is in master control. He's always got our back. He's on deck with us at MasculineUs Live. And I have to send out my accolades to those two guys. Cliff is back in public equipment.
Okay.
He's shoving out equipment today. And you know we got security on deck, so don't even try it up in here. We got him on deck, and he came in wearing a Pittsburgh Steeler outfit, so you know what time it is. Listen, we are Brick TV is a not-for-profit community TV channel. Listen, they're on the fourth channel, but this is Brooklyn Free Speech. and Brooklyn's free speech airs exclusively on Spectrum 1995, 1996, 1997, and 1998. We're on 1997, and we're on Optimum 67, 68. We're on Channel 69. I kind of dig that. It has nothing to do with anybody out there. It's a personal thing for me. RCN, Channel 82, 83. We're on Channel 84, and there's a Channel 85. Watch all throughout New York City on Verizon Fios. Also, 42, 43. We're on Channel 44. They have a 45 channel, but remember, we're on the third channel, okay?
Cool.
And listen, we're doing this. We had a lot of channels here, but we're, like I said, we're here every Wednesday from 8 to 9 p.m. This is not mainstream television. This is community access. I know usually they have a very popular show that comes on Wednesday at 9 p.m. Listen, man, it's all good. Our phone lines are open right now at 718-237-1658. Sheba Legend, I'm here with screenwriter Kate Lanier in the flesh. Kate, talk to us more about the process. Listen, I'm going to tell you what happened to me today. How you doing today?
I'm doing good.
Yeah.
I'm doing good. It's cold, but I'm good.
Well, you're from California. You live in California
now,
so of course.
I got thin blood
now. It's
cold,
but it's not so hot where you're at.
No.
You're right on the ocean, so it's not that hot.
Right.
But I got to tell you about my day. This
tell
is
me.
The second move that I've made with a friend. First one was in Florida last week. I helped a friend of mine, Richard Alvarez, reset.
Amazing artist.
Yeah, he's an amazing artist. You can go to richardalvarez.com or catch him on Facebook. He paints on plexiglass and glass.
Wow.
It's like amazing work. Anyway, I was down with him, helped him move to a new studio, which was amazing. Cannot wait to get back down there and see that studio, what you've done with it, Richard. And today, I helped another friend of mine move. He's like my soul brother. He is a soul brother, Natty Soul Man. He's also on social media. He's very conscious. Like, you know, everybody's got, I hope everyone's got a friend who wears a dashiki and wears their hair, naturally and keeps his beard. And he's very, positive and pro and, you know, all those things. And I helped him move today. So I'm sore as shit.
Oh, man.
Yeah. But I went to Target today because I was missing a SD card for tonight.
Okay.
I couldn't use any of my other SD cards. So I went to Target and I got the ratchetness. I got treated like a second, third class citizen.
Really?
Yeah, it was tough.
You know,
by two Target associates. And of course I asked for the manager and I told them what happened and she assured me that she would handle the situation, but I wrote her name down anyway. Hey, we got a phone call. Let's take this call and I'll get back to that story in a minute.
Okay.
Get your headphones on. Hey, caller, who's this and where you calling from?
Hi, Sheba. Emma.
Hey, Emma, what's happening, baby?
Everything's good. I see that you got a very important person as a guest on your show today.
Yeah, we always have important people on here. We got important people calling here. We got important people sitting in here. Listen, everyone, Ammo is a community producer here at Brooklyn Free Speech.
Nice.
Ammo has helped, has gotten involved with a couple of projects that I know about with Flash Russo and those Kings County Chiefs. Those champion mini football leaguers, male and female football team. I met Ammo through a fellow producer here, Kevin Lawrence, and I asked her to help, and she jumped right in. What's happening, Ammo? Talk to
us. What's up, Sheba? So I noticed that, you mentioned that she's wrote, Kate, you wrote a lot of well-known films in the mainstream. Set it off with one of my favorite. In fact, the hairstyle that I have, I based off of Jada Pinkett's hairstyle from that movie.
Right on.
Yeah,
and I really admired that movie so much that I wanted to do a remake of it.
Oh,
or
okay.
Something similar.
Right.
And I had no idea that it was you, really.
That's right.
I have some advice, I write. I mean, that's some advice. I want to ask them some advice.
Yeah, please.
My trouble is I always get writer's block. What can I do to help me with that writer's block?
Well, I think that writer's block can come in many different forms, right? So sometimes for me, I have noticed, so now I can kind of observe it happening. There's the writer's block where you are literally don't have the idea, right?
Mm-hmm.
And when that happens, what I do is I look to things to get inspired for the idea. So for example, I might have a character, I might have a setup and a conflict, but I don't know where it's going to go. Mm-hmm. So I try to look for inspirational. For me, it's reading a lot. You know, books that I'm reading, movies I'll watch, that will just trigger a thought or a thought process that will get me to the next piece of the structure. Okay, that's one kind of writer's block where you're out of ideas. The other writer's block is I have all the ideas laid out. I have a structure laid out. I know who my characters are. Mm-hmm. For me, the dialogue and characters just, I channel something else that flows.
Right.
So I have it all out, but I can't bring myself to sit down and do it. And when that happens, there's one or two things I do is that I found that I have to do something with my body, and that gets it flowing where I can actually sit and do the work. I have it all outlined, I just am stuck.
Now, when you say do something with your body, give me an example. Like, you're talking about exercise, stretching?
Exercise. Yeah. So I'll either do a yoga practice, but you got to do like at least 20, 45 minutes so that you're in that. Because it actually, come to find out, this is something that I just discovered. I've always done this, but I've discovered that the connections in your brain, the process of
it like wakes up or
your
like
brain working is actually dependent on your physical activity. So when I, you know, I go take a walk like really fast, do some yoga, run, do something.
You used to
and
climb
I know
six
that.
Stories
I
of
out,
steps
yoga,
at the house.
So I do something, and then when I sit down, I'm able to go. I'm able to just go. And then some of it is just kind of a discipline where if you do it enough, where you just sit there and you just pen to paper or keyboard, whatever you do, if you've done it enough, it's like anything, like I was saying, like going to the gym, right? The first couple of times you go to the gym to lift a weight, it's like, oh, it's a struggle. It's hard. But if you keep going back and doing it, all of a sudden that weight, you can do it.
Yeah.
You've developed the muscle. Same thing when you sit down to the keyboard. You just say, I'm going to sit here for an hour no matter what, period. And it flows. Well, if you keep doing that, it will start to come.
Right on.
Yeah.
Right
That's
on,
awesome. That's great advice.
Right on.
And, you know, I always find myself, you know, I find myself with a bunch of ideas, like you said. And the other issue that I have other than blocking is I feel cluttered. And I don't know how to organize my thoughts. And I feel like the story is going to be so great, but then I don't have nothing on paper because I'm like,
right.
where is it going?
Right. And so some of that is understanding that every movie follows a particular structure. You can play with that structure, but you got to get those three acts down. So a film, unlike a book or a memoir, is confined generally to 120 minutes, a little more, a little less. So you're telling a story in a very particular structure. So you have a first act, a second act, and a third act. So if you know what that is supposed to look like, okay, we're supposed to start by setting up character, setting up a conflict. That pulls us in. How is it going to get resolved, right?
Right.
Throw something else in. You know, you're building in this three-act structure in a way that creates tension and pulls an audience along. So you can't, that makes it easier in a way. You don't just start off writing not knowing where you're going.
Yeah.
you gotta create that outline.
That's
right?
That's my thing. Like,
right.
She looks at it like, sis.
Oh,
What are you doing?
So what about, so what if I have all of that, right? And
right.
I'm writing, and all of a sudden I get another idea put in. Should I just leave it alone, or should I, like, add it in? Because sometimes I find out, I wind up getting stuck from that point. But
right.
I have my ending, and I have my beginning. But it's, like, a twist that I want to bring in. I think it's just out of desperation of, like, wanting my audience to be more drawn in, but I don't want to lose them.
Well, you know what, here's the thing. Always do more, because you're going to go back. I mean, I've never done more than, you know, 19 revisions on a script is like the least amount I've done, right? So if you think of it that way, that first draft is just a first draft. You know, you follow your outline, but if you want to throw in some new, that's fine. Get back to your outline. You can always go back and refine it or cut it out. So you're always... So don't worry so much that what you're putting down is going to be the final thing. Like, just don't worry about it. Just
add.
You're going to go back. You're going to cut. You're going to refine. You're going to do that again. You're going to do it again. You're going to do it, you know, 10, 20 times. So once you have it all on paper, then you go back and you can look at it and say, okay, how is this piece of it moving it forward? Do I need it? Is it necessary for the story? Is it necessary for a character?
But at the bare minimum, you have something to work with.
Exactly.
You know, you have, like, something that can either add to it or not, you know?
Right.
Or not.
It's almost better to have more than less, okay?
Great.
Ammo.
That's awesome.
More, shave it off. Shave it off later on, right?
Are you going to be here after the show, Ammo?
Yes, I definitely want to give her a hug.
Oh, yeah, give her a hug afterwards. Hang up that phone, because we got more callers on. That's Ammo, everybody. She's
all
a
right.
Community producer. Thank you for calling in, beautiful.
Bye.
Right on. So, listen.
Yeah.
It's just a matter. I want to talk to you about, since we're on the creative process.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of people who are aware of the structure of...
Yes.
Screenwriting, so
right.
to speak. I wanted to see if you can give us a really short synopsis
mm-hmm.
of, like, screenwriting 101. Right? The basics.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Like a story.
Okay.
Or direction. Or
right.
whatever it
right,
is.
Right.
Give me three to five...
Three to five
most important things for you in past and present,
yeah.
that you recognize as a viable tool.
Okay, so I would say...
For your writing.
Once you have the structure of a screenplay down, and that takes years, it kind of becomes, it's like a math problem. You understand how it's structured. You understand how to set things up to get to the end you want, right? It becomes second nature. It's like, oh, I know how to figure this problem out. Then the most important piece of it is character. So you need to be able to come up with characters that are relatable and interesting. So I always say start a story with a character. Who are your characters? Are they real? What's their conflict? Inner conflict, external conflict. So that's the other piece of it, is you've got to decide, you know, who is my character? What's their conflict? So let's say I start off with Sheba Lane, character. Now, you could have a conflict that's very external. You could be chased down by a gang of bullies.
Well, been treated like shit in the local
Target
in downtown
right?
Brooklyn.
And
yeah.
they're calling the police because they've decided that you robbed something, which you didn't.
No, I didn't.
And that's an external conflict. You're running from the police. The conflict is outside of you. Now, it may, as the story develops, reflect something that's very
internal.
You maybe have been... very conflicted about a relationship you're in, You know, you're with someone, but you want to be with someone else. That's an internal conflict. And a whole story can be about that. We meet a character who's a piano teacher, and she is
blind.
Been married for 25 years, and she loves her husband, but she has a new student who's come in. He's a younger man.
He's hot.
He's hot, and she's feeling drawn to him.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. And so you set up a conflict there, but then there's a reveal, could be that she's about to present a new composition to the board of what, I know nothing about music, but she's about to present a composition that's gonna be played at Carnegie Hall. And what she doesn't know when she makes the choice between her husband and this young man is that he's actually in the same competition and he's secretly stealing her music. You see what I'm talking
about? Tight.
You get
thing.
A new conflict.
He's a tired young tight thing. That's what they do. You know that, right?
I do.
And they say it's all theirs. You tired young tight thing. Be gone. You've revealed.
Yeah. What we don't know is that the whole time, as she has decided to have an affair with this young man, we, the audience, see that her husband of 25 years is secretly peeping the whole situation.
He's gonna
he
kill
knows
he's
what's
gonna
going
kill, he's
on.
Gonna kill, he's gonna divorce her, take
he's
all the money.
He's gonna kill her.
He's gonna kill her.
Kill
and,
him.
And then, no, he's gonna kill her and then frame him for her murder.
Exactly. Gonna take the music and pretend it's his own and win the competition.
What do you mean you don't know anything about music? You know about Tina Turner.
No, you know, I don't know about
You wrote the shit out of her story, huh?
Yeah.
You wrote the shit out of that story. Listen, what's love got to do with it? You wrote the shit out of that story. Girl, you turned Ike out.
It was shocking. At the time, it was shocking.
It was shocking, but you know about music.
Yeah.
I've been in the club with you. You know about music.
I know, I do.
You know Bangles here for her. You know Miley Cyrus happening on this end of the stick.
No, we
listen to classic soul now. Anyway, it's 8:28. You're watching MasculineUs live. And I'm Sheba Legend. I'm your host tonight, as I am every Wednesday night. I'm sitting here with Kate Lanier, screenwriter extraordinaire. Listen, Sahara Briscoe is usually sitting in the co-pilot seat. She's been sort of doing some other things. She's, you know, Sahara's badass, man.
What's she do?
Yeah, Sahara is a textile artist.
Wow.
If you go to superstringtheory.com and see her work, let me tell you, museum
Amazing.
Pieces.
Really?
Over. She still spins a wheel. She weaves. She weaves. I brought her some sheep here.
No.
You ever see a kid get excited about a box of toys? That was Sahara.
Wow.
I'm talking about sheep here. You know, and one bag was
black.
Oh, did
you bring it from Johnny's Ranch?
Yeah, bring it from Johnny's Ranch. Yeah. So, you know, big up to Sahara Briscoe. I hope to see you here next week again. She'll be back next week, you guys. She just have been a bit deflated, you know. The holidays are tough, man. You came in for the holy days. I had the pleasure of having the first day of Hanukkah with you guys celebrating.
And Kate, Christmas.
Yeah, and Christmas as well with friends and family. It's really important to me that I see my nephews, your sons, and I see you on a regular basis.
That's right.
I get to exchange information with you because social media and texting and all that stuff isn't enough. We come from face-to-face action.
Face-to-face.
That's what it's about.
You remember when we go out and we have to figure out where the next club party was? You'd go to a payphone.
Yeah, go to payphone.
Go to the payphone.
Or you remember that somebody said this club.
Right.
And depending on that person, that was the decision on whether or not you took the chance or not.
Right.
Like, who told you they were going... Who's going to, save the robot?
Save the robot after
area.
Garage.
Who's going to paradise? Who's playing music? Is Larry there yet?
Yeah.
You know, is Larry there at 5 o'clock. No, right. He's not there yet. Where is he?
So we'll go to save the robot.
We'll go to the robot, and then we'll bounce to the ground. You know, go to paradise. So that's where we come from. Like, you know, offerings are very important too.
Yeah.
So that I don't want to talk about any of your spiritual practices, but it's been an honor and a blessing to be with you in that realm of spirituality.
Yeah.
And we have similar practices that we do. And it's all honoring our ancestral
lineage.
It's all
about the ancestors.
It's all about ancestors.
Yeah.
And staying in the moment, asking for their assistance and staying in the moment.
Right.
You know, and helping to keep my armor, my spiritual armor intact until things come to fruition. Fruition.
Right.
Good, bad, or indifferent.
That's
you know,
good, because you can't, you know what they say, you can't stay full on yesterday's hamburger.
Yeah.
Right? It's a daily practice. So I wake up every morning, do my prayer, meditation, talk to my ancestors.
Mm-hmm. And make those offers. Listen, I wanted to talk to you also about your process and some of the challenges that you faced. As a writer in Hollywood, you know?
Well, let's talk about the fact that Hollywood, you know, the film industry, although it's getting better, is very much a male-dominated industry, okay? So there are a lot of women writers. There are women who, write romantic films, dramas, but ultimately there are probably 80% of directors are men. Okay, so you are, you know, the director is calling the shots on a film. What I've experienced is not only do women make a lot less money, but they aren't hired on the big projects where you're going to make a ton of money. You know, you're not going to get hired to write the Die Hard or the, you know, Star Wars. Like I said, it's getting better. You don't generally have women, aside from like Catherine Bigelow. She really broke a lot of barriers, you know, a lot of ceilings.
And Catherine Bigelow is
Hurt Locker. You know, she's been doing more action, what people would label as male-driven stories, right? And so male-driven stories are the ones who are going to star the Tom Cruise, the Will Smith, the highest paid actors who draw the biggest box office. So it always comes down to who's going to bring in the box office, who's going to make the most money for a movie is going to be a male star, right? And that director of that project is going to be male, and they're going to tend to want to hire a male screenwriter. So on balance, yes, there are movies being written by women and being directed by women, but the ones with the biggest budget that get the biggest box office are generally directed by men.
Understood. I want to set up a scenario for you.
Yeah.
With the Tina Turner story.
Yeah.
How did that happen for you? Is it okay if I ask? How did that happen for you?
I had sold a movie. I sold my first movie to Warner Brothers, right? And then had gotten a couple of other sort of bites for jobs, and then I went in to meet with the two producers who had optioned Tina Turner's autobiography called I, Tina.
Now, when you say optioned,
right?
When you say optioned, that's on like a pitch. Is it a pitch?
No, that means is they said, they called the publisher, whoever had, you know, published the book, and said, we want to turn this into a movie. Can we have the option on this? They were producers. And they were looking to hire a writer so they could set it up somewhere, right? So, yeah, I went in to pitch to them. how I saw the movie taking place, then they hired me. So they liked what I came up with as far as how to tell her a story. They liked that. Then they, I think they might have already set it up at Touchstone, which was an arm of Disney at the time. So then, you know, I ended up getting hired to write that script. And that's how that went down, right, you know. Right. So it was, you know, but I read her book, but her book was really long. I ended up talking to, like, some of the ICATs, talking to people who were in her life at that time. She sent me tape recordings of herself talking about her life. I got a lot of different information and went from there. Yeah.
Well, I can imagine the feeling that you had while you were doing that and the importance of her story as it was factual.
Yeah.
How close to factual can you say that story?
Here's what I like to say in terms of writing, because I've done some biopics. Mm-hmm. Again, because you're dealing with a two-hour movie that has a structure, you cannot put in every detail of everyone's life, right? So I feel like it was truthful to the spirit of what she went through, truthful to the spirit of the various conflicts and events that happened, but not necessarily factual. I had to change things to make it work within the structure of 2 hours.
Right.
So for example, I'll give you an example. There was never one moment where she turned to Ike and beat him with her shoe. Like, that never happened. I made that up. Because in reality, she left him and came back and left like 17 times. You can't do that in a movie. We had to create a moment where she finally went, all right, I'm done, and left. So again, the specific steps of how she ended up leaving him, you can't do when you're telling a story.
Right on, right on.
Within a film structure.
And that's part of the add.
Right.
Did that adding get you to that transition?
No, that was more like, okay, how do I, you know, in trying to structure the whole thing out, how do I get to that place? How do I build the tension and get to that place and tell it in a scene or in a moment that would work for the movie? Mm-hmm. You know, because the facts were gonna take forever.
Right?
It's not a documentary. That's where film is telling a story. It's not documenting. It's creating a tale. It's creating fiction in a way. You're fictionalizing to tell the truth.
Got it. Now, I set you
up. That makes sense.
That does make sense. I set you up with that because on the back end of that, TLC.
Right,
you told me a little bit about the back end to that story, how they sort you out.
Yeah.
And wanted you to do their story.
Right.
In which it turned out to be a huge, ratings craze. Like, it was insane.
Yeah,
A ratings juggernaut.
Right.
Historically, you know, for VH1.
Right.
It was the highest rating, whatever, movie, you know. So how was that initial? Because I know we used to listen to, like, you know.
Yeah.
And for them to reach out to, and, you know, Tina Turner, too. I mean, how was it, like, when your agent was like,
right.
Was it like we got a call from TLC and they want you to write this film?
Yeah, exactly. No, it was cool, but because even though I listened to their music, I didn't really know about the stories. I mean, I knew that Lisa had died, right? Yeah. And so Tion and Chili were the two members left. And I kind of heard some drama here and there about stuff that had gone down in their lives. Like, I remember watching on TV when Lisa burned down Andre's house, you know, footballer she was with, right? Stuff like that. So, but I didn't really know. And so I was like, okay, is this, you know, let me see how interesting this is going to be. And so I sat down with them and they kind of told me some of the stories of stuff that was going on back in the day that people didn't know about. And I was like, okay, so this could be a good, good story, because there was some drama and there was some conflict. There was some internal conflict. There was all those elements that I felt like I had the skill to weave together.
Right on.
Their story.
Successful piece, and I thank you for that, for sticking with that.
Yeah.
You know, you did Mariah Carey, but the studios got a hold of that. And,
that was, again, nothing to do with Mariah's life. And what I will say is that she is one of the smartest, most creative, generous people I've ever worked with. I mean, Mariah is amazing. And she wanted to tell a story that was really not related to her life, except for the fact that the character was a singer. She wanted a sort of fictional tale that we came up with. To make a long story short, we had written something that was sort of dark and gritty and painful. And at the end of the day, Sony, which was the studio who was doing her movie, were, I think at some point they realized that her audience was going to be PG-13.
Mm.
Okay, and we couldn't, you know, they didn't want to do the script
it
the way it was. So they
it
had
happen.
To choppity-chop-chop a lot of it, right?
Yeah.
Not to mention that the movie came out, I think it was 9 days after 9/11.
You don't release a movie 9 days after 9/11. A disaster.
People were not going to the movies to see a Mariah
Carey
movie.
People are not going anywhere outside of their home. People are still cowering under their beds. People are paranoid.
Yeah.
There's no social, like, activity.
And the newspapers were, like, no one was covering. There was zero press. No one was covering, like, what movies were opening that week.
Bad timing.
You know?
But I want to talk to you about some of the projects that you're working on now.
Yeah.
I did want to mention, like, your first, but my favorite, Set It Off.
Yeah.
I really wanted to mention to you that was a badass film, especially for that time, and it's still relevant.
Right.
You know, and I tell you, there's reruns. Or Set It Off reruns all the time. And the distributing of that film has been, you know, people, distributors have bought and aired.
Right.
I mean, it's still going. It's still going. Thank you for that, too. I want to talk about what you're working on now.
Yeah.
If you can talk to us about that. And,
sure. So I wrote a pilot for, it's going to be on BET. It's called Rebel. John Singleton is directing. He's also an executive producer along with Dallas Jackson and myself.
Oh, right.
Okay. So that's a story that is going to start with this 2-hour movie I wrote and then is hopefully going to spin off into a series.
Right on. So this is your first stab at television? Is that what's happening?
Yeah, pretty much.
Besides community access.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey.
It's the first time. So good luck with that. I'll be looking forward to seeing
BET Rebel.
Anything
check it out.
Anything else you got on the hot plate that you want to talk to us about?
So I wrote another movie for Queen Latifah.
La.
So, and it looks like that's being optioned at Lionsgate, and so we'll see what happens.
Right on. Good stuff. So listen, we're at 8:44. We're about 10-12 minutes out. I'm sitting here with Kate Lanier. My name is Sheba Legend, and you are watching Masculine Us Live. Our phone lines are open at 718-237-1634. And, Kate, I just want to give a shout-out to my nephews, your sons, Henry and Tyrone.
Hi, Henry.
L. What's
Hello.
Up, you two? They're all here from California this week for the New Year's. Hey, we're going to dance this New Year's Day.
Of course.
We usually dance every New Year's Day. We get to see as many friends of ours at once as possible here in New York.
Right.
And I don't know if we're going to be at Outpost in Brooklyn, New York City.
We're going to find out.
Or we're going to be at 718.
Yeah.
It's a 718 party. And I don't know if we're going to be at Outpost or Santos Party House in Manhattan.
But now, can the boys come?
I don't know.
Do you have to be Over 18?
I think so. I think you got. I think you got to be like, if there's alcohol in the house, you got to kind of be. Yeah, I think you got to be like 21 or something.
Right.
But Benny Soto, you know, you remember Benny? Benny is the pilot for that and for that 718 sessions, and he's been teamed up with Danny Cribbett for quite some time. Benny Soto is the premier nightlife promoter.
Okay.
Who comes from where we come from, New York City nightlife culture in the 1980s. And he's definitely made his mark in New York and around the world with spreading the love of music, you know, and
speaking
dancing.
Of music, I got to give a shout out to my man's band, the DTs. Go to Spotify, like the DTs, capital D, capital T, E-A-S-E. DTs. You like hardcore rock and roll.
Mike, what's up? Back in Santa Boo Boo, he left
Santa
yesterday.
Left yesterday. Check out the DTs. Hit him up.
Yeah, and
Facebook, Spotify,
DTs.
Alike.
And Dead
alike.
And Dead End Cemetery
and Dead
too.
Dead End Cemetery.
Yeah.
Dead End Cemetery.
That's right. That's right.
My son's punk rock band. If you're into. Right, like old school hardcore punk.
DOA, you know, Dead Kennedys.
Check out,
you know what I mean?
Dead End Cemetery. They play all around Santa Barbara, Ventura, Cali. If you're in town, you can check them out.
Right on, right on.
But like them.
Like them on Facebook. Like Masculine. Hey, like Masculine.
That's right.
And we're on Facebook too. Listen, this is a not for profit project.
Right.
We've been doing this.
We've been on air for about two.
This is our second year, but
the
project has been in existence for about 7 years.
Right.
And I've been documenting not only women who strong women.
Right.
It doesn't necessarily end up in a three-piece men's suit either. You know.
Right. Right.
For me, you're a strong woman.
Right.
You're a sense of strength, a source of strength for me.
Yeah.
You know, you're a reflection. And listen, it doesn't mean that she's same gender loving. You know what I mean?
Right.
That's not the point. The point is cultivating that strength and persevering through whatever, you know?
Sure.
Despite you being female, despite you being ostracized to a large degree and being female, the thing is your natural position of strength has been intact throughout the years. And you may not see that, Kate, sometimes.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I see it. I know your story.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I know your story. So I want to thank you for showing up here tonight. We're at 8:48. I want to ask you about, you know, the sulky part of it. I don't mean to, put it out there
there.
You know, setting up you walking into the board, the pitch room.
Right.
And they're expecting, this hip, darker skin person to write a film that is geared towards a more darker skin person.
Right. Well, here's how I feel about it. Is first of all, I look white, but my heritage is very mixed. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm half Jewish. My dad's side of the family is all kinds of stuff going on there.
There's me.
My sister, Sheba. So, but I think you write about what moves you and what you're close to. You know, they always say, write what you know. Okay, write what you know. And so in that way, I don't think you can look at someone and go, oh, they know how to represent this. Okay? You are going to be unable to represent a super frilly girly person in your writing because you don't look that way. So I think that's a mistake.
In
writing, you have to look at a person's craft. Okay, so for me personally, the people that I felt that I aligned myself to naturally and gravitated to growing up in this very urban, mixed environment, you know, we're always black people. We're always black folk. That's how I learned to laugh and dance. And, you know, it was Puerto Rican, Dominican, black. Like, I gravitated to that. I don't know, something deep in my blood. You know, there's parts of me that who knows? You know, I can't tell you, but what I do know is that probably if I spent some time with some, you know, South Asian folk, and really got to understand what they're about and what their heart was and what their culture and how I felt, you know, we're all just human, I'd be able to tell their story. Mm-hmm. So it's about the craft, bottom line. Now, right. But I totally understand that people in the film industry who want to make films that represent their culture, their people accurately, are going to look at someone and say, oh, they can't do that, right? And I'm all for getting more African-American writers into writers' rooms. Like, definitely. Let's make it as real as possible.
Right on.
But at the end of the day, I don't think you can judge. And it is really a problem in Hollywood and everywhere. It's like judging people by their looks. It's such a look situation. Okay, so even ageism, you know, so I've been doing this, when I started off, I was like young, cute, fly, whatever. Now I'm older, I can see some things that I'm pitching that are more young and hip. They see me walk into a room and they're like, oh, she don't have her edge. She doesn't have an edge. She doesn't know what's going on, really, with young. So anyway, that's what I have to say about that.
We got a call.
Yeah.
Hold on a second. Did you hang up? Call back, caller. Where you at, baby? We picked up the phone on you and you hung up.
So what I'm saying, you know, I think it really comes down to craft. If you're a good craftsman and you really have your heart in it, you can convey anything.
Well, you obviously wrote the shit out of a few films that were very good, that were very... true to nature, in a natural
right.
sense. And I got to tell you, some of the characters, like Queen Latifah's character, mm-hmm. Set It Off, reminded me of me. And
right.
reminded me of, you know, in who, you know, I don't think I've seen that character on
right.
film at that point. I'd never seen a character
right.
like that on the screen.
Right.
You know, that, like, that was, that lasted, like, more than 3 seconds.
Right.
You know, usually,
right.
you know, women or same gender women who were of color,
mm-hmm.
More aggressive,
yeah.
were, you know, in prison
right.
or chalk lined out in the street.
Right.
You know what
yeah.
I mean? That's that up until that point,
yeah.
I hadn't seen
yeah.
any women depicted in that way, in that manner, in that character. And you did
right.
a great job with that.
Yeah,
by
thanks.
The way. Yeah, yeah.
Thanks,
so,
sis.
So listen, it's 8:53. We got a few more minutes before we head out the door. I'm sitting here with screenwriter Kate Lanier. I'm Sheba Legend. You are watching Masculine Us, and we are promoting positive perspectives in our societies to you know, promote bridging our communities.
Right,
and,
right.
You know, therefore... How do we do that with art?
Yeah.
You know, when there's
and community.
And
getting community together around
yeah.
art.
Yeah.
You know, and expression and understanding, you know, the humanity.
Yeah. I love collaborating. You know,
yeah.
that's what you guys taught me back in the day in the 80s.
Right.
Like, collaboration is so important that you had to contribute. You
yes.
know, I was a dishwasher for a long
mm-hmm.
time, and when I got my chance to contribute, I recognized it.
Yeah,
I stood my ground. I didn't take pennies on the dollars. I was asking for top dollar, even though I didn't know what the hell I was doing.
Yeah.
I didn't know what I was getting myself
yeah.
into. But I did what I had to do, and I was damn good at it. And I understood that I was contributing to the group that we belong to.
Right.
You know, a
right.
little over 500 of us, 500 creatives.
Yeah.
moving about in the same circles, contributing.
And you know why we were able to feel, we were able to feel like we had the freedom to contribute?
Mm-hmm.
Because we were not so blocked mm-hmm. by money. Okay, it was like, oh yeah, hell yeah, I'll get a little apartment for nothing. I'll get some little job, bartending here or there, but spend my days making art.
Yeah.
Knowing, we didn't feel like, oh damn, there's a ceiling. I need this much money in order to be able to do my art.
Right.
I need this much money to live, so I'm just hustling around the clock trying to make money.
We were really good grinders.
We were good grinders, but we had a kind of a sense of like, oh, I can do, oh, she's writing, I can write.
Right.
He's making music, I can do that. There wasn't that sense of like, oh, you need this much capital. Oh, you need this much money. We weren't talking about money so much. Yeah. We're like, how can we make art?
Yeah, and then we came from an age where, you know, we didn't really starve as artists.
No. There was enough.
There was enough.
There was enough places to live, enough spaces to make art, enough possibility. You felt the possibility.
Yeah, and those of us who made it early shared their wealth with us. You know, we would
end up
at Mr. Chow's a lot and Indochine. We got a call. Hold on a second. Hello, caller. Who's this and where you calling from?
Sheba.
Hey.
Hi, Sheba.
Is this Crystal?
You got to repeat your show next week. This is Crystal.
Hey, Crystal. Crystal's one of our regular callers, our regular watchers.
Crystal.
Hi, Crystal.
Hi.
How are you? What's going on, sis?
You're
going
to have to repeat the show next week. I want to see it from the top.
Okay.
And you said you had 500 people you worked with your program. Getting these, a lot of things you said this evening, because I'm trying to better myself, and I want to know. You know what I'm trying to say, Sheba?
I know what you're trying to say, Crystal.
Hello?
You hear me, Crystal?
I can hear you.
Listen, I know you, Chris.
I want to be industrious. I want to grow. I want to leave this planet knowing that I did something.
Yeah.
I think you're going to help. So do me a favor. Re-air the program next week or one day next month or something.
You got it, Crystal. We got about 30 seconds going on. Say hello to Kate Lanier. I want to thank her for coming on the show.
How
I want to
you
thank
doing?
You for calling in. I want to thank everybody for calling in and watching this evening.
So yeah, my name is Young Tev. I want to give a shout out to Masculine Us. Meet Jaffy one time. Love his audience, make some noise. This ain't 106, this is great.
Okay, I see these niggas hating. I ain't never stressed, this is steady paper chasing. Flying in a spaceship, that nigga swag basic. I told you I'm the one, catch me fucking up the matrix. Burning paper planes to the face till I'm faded. Sipping on the rim, he got a nigga feeling wasted. Girls on the ramp wanting me to take them down. You already know I'll buy them all another round. Young tap, yes sir. Flow something, I'm sir. Yeah, we in this bitch, killing shit like a cancer. Blowing on the loud and VIP with our hands up. Looking at the haters like I know you can't stand us. Soldiers on deck and I might have that thing tucked. Niggas know the rules, don't start it, won't be none. Bottle after bottle, I be drinking to my face up. Shout out to the haters that be hating.
Best Nation. I got nothing to
lose. Yes. Shorty right across from me wearing no blizzard. Dressed to impress, looking like a scissor. I can't wait to get her home in my hot blizzard. I ain't gotta ask twice, I'ma hit that ass twice. Preferably in one night, tough keep a game tight. Entertain a more of you, then on to the next ride. Cause I do this here, I ain't worried about you lambs in your corny little stairs. We popping over here, bring nothing over there. The bottles and the mottos, it's all over here. I love you little niggas, I don't really give a damn. That trash anyway, I'll give glass to your fear. Why you mad? I can't comprehend. You secretly hate it, but still wanna be my friend.
Rock on, 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 r this is for my